Hey, Crosstown, welcome to this year's Crosstown Rewind, where we review 2023 and see all of what God has done in and through the church. And so joining me today are our campus pastors. Welcome, guys.
Thank you.
Are you happy to be here?
We are good. We are glad to be here.
Okay, good. Good. This, I love this filming. I love when we do this. We struggle through it. Because we're not professional.
We have
actors.
A lot of laughs.
Yes, but we have a good time. But we started, if you guys remember, 2023 off with a bang by praying. We believe at Crosstown that prayer is a priority. And because of that, we took the first 21 days to devote to God to see what he would do in and through the church. Because we believe that prayer drives the church. And it really did. Several of the campuses got together to worship with one another, and it was an amazing thing that led to not one, not two, but three salvations and 10 people going public with their faith in Christ. They were baptized, one of which was a gentleman by the name of Josh Freer, and you guys know Josh. He's currently in our elder candidacy program, learning theology and doctrine and how to serve the body of Christ. So, I mean, just praise God for what he's doing. So change lives. Prayer moved the church by changing lives. And it also moved the church in relation to our emphasis on mission and vision. We were in the middle of a series called Church in 3D. Hopefully you guys remember that. It was a vision-related series to emphasize the three Ds of our church and the vision. So we exist to lead people to discover, develop, and display full devotion to Jesus Christ. And I remember saying to our church that when you've found the greatest news in the history of the world, you'll naturally want to share it with other people. Yep. It's one of our core values. Find people. He first found his own brother. Who's he? That's Andrew. He first found his own brother, Simon, and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which means Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Andrew's first priority when he finds this Messiah, he goes to find his brother and he brings his brother to Jesus. And that, church, serves us with a great principle. And that is this. People come to know Jesus when those who have been found go find others who don't know Jesus and then bring them to Jesus. And so the application for us is simply this, that those who truly know go find others who need to know. What a great reminder, church, that found people find people. When you discover the greatest news in the history of the world, you'll naturally want to share it with other people. And as we rolled into February, that theme of changed lives and prayer and seeing God move continued. At our Arcade campus specifically, we have a great ministry. Pastor Stu and the team there do a great job ministering to Houghton University students every single week. 20, 30, sometimes even 40 students come in droves to worship with that congregation. And we remember one week where God changed someone's life for eternity.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I remember that week I got a chance to go and back and pray with Joseph, and grew up in the church, but really would consider himself an agnostic. But God just got a hold of his heart. He started coming across town with friends, and God has just gotten a hold of his heart. And that day, he gave his heart to the Lord. Awesome. And it was awesome to be able to pray with him. And then it's been fun to watch him throughout. You know, he was baptized then in May, and now just growing and serving, and just an awesome story. Awesome story of God's faithfulness.
That's so cool. And then in February, we also had our annual snow camp. And so joining us to tell us more about that is Pastor Jonathan, our student pastor over Roots here in Wellsville, as well as Shinglehouse.
Right.
So tell us a little bit about what God did at Snow Camp 2023.
Oh, absolutely. For the first time ever, snow camp did not have snow. So we had to deal with some dust and mud.
The mud camp, right?
Yeah, pretty much. But that didn't stop spiritual things from happening. We had some new adults pouring into these students' lives, had 79 students show up. Wow. And at the end of camp, something absolutely special happened. I offered to, if you need some prayer, come up, and we have some adults willing to pray with you. And wouldn't you know it, every single team went up to be prayed for by their leaders.
What a moment.
Yeah, absolutely. Beautiful moment.
Yeah. So we would be missing a big moment if we didn't recap what God did in 2023. So check out this year's snow camp video.
What up, C-Town? If you ain't at mud camp, then where you at?
I was at a loss until you found me. You gave me your home, you gave me your love. I was running blind until you showed me that life could be this good. I want all my friends to know about you. No matter what it takes, I'll never stop. Everything I am is for your glory. My life's forever yours. I found one love, can't control it. Hit me like a wildfire, send me in motion. Nothing else compares, losing all my cares. Now that I have found one love, one, one.
That's so cool.
See how God's working in our students' lives. Yep. In March, we continued our series on the Gospel of Luke. Yep. And looking at the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And in that series, part six, I preached a message called Taxpayers and Image Bearers. And it's the analogy of the illustration that I used was the Roman coin, and where Jesus asked people, whose image on that coin do you see? And there was a really relevant message that we needed to consider for our lives. So check out this clip. Look what he says in verse 25. He says, then render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. The Bible teaches us, if you don't know, if you're new to the Bible, this is really important stuff. The Bible teaches us that we're made in the image and likeness of God. Not only if you're a believer, if you're a Christian, but even non-Christians, we're all made in the image of God. See Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, where God says, let us, plural, God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He says, let us make man and women in our image, in our likeness. We are made with the imprint, literally the stamp of God on our lives. On any coin that you have, there's an image on it. But in the Roman world, there was an image of Caesar. It was called a denarius. And so take a look. This would be an image of Caesar on this denarius. And so think about what Jesus is saying here. He's saying, whose image is on that coin? And you would say, and Jesus would say, well, just give it back to him then, because it belongs to him. But he would also say to you, whose image is on your life? And you would say, God's, Jesus. And so Jesus would say, then wouldn't it make sense to give your life back to him? Do you see what Jesus is doing by answering this question? He kind of flips the conversation from taxes to what should be our ultimate treasure, and that is God. So think about the application. I think the application is pretty simple for us to walk away with today, and that is this. Give God what is God's. Are you giving to God what is God's? Mm-hmm. And what is God's is our life, and we need to make him our treasure with our life. And Pastor Tim, you had this great testimony around that same time in March of someone having to wrestle with that very same question.
A long time ago, like 10 years ago, Jamie was shot in a hunting accident. Mike Rulo was right there to basically help save Jamie's life. I mean, he probably could have died. Fast forward, he knew Mike Rulo for years, you know, and Mike ended up with cancer, and Jamie just felt the real need to go to Mike and say, there's a very real thing gonna happen here. Mike, you're dying of cancer. Are you ready to meet Jesus? And Mike gave his life to Christ. Jamie was able to pray with him. There's a really neat way to watch how that kind of came full circle. Mike was there to help save Jamie's life physically. And Jamie, in turn, years later, was able to help save or be an ambassador for Christ so that Mike got saved spiritually.
Amen. Amen. Powerful. Now, at the end of the month, Aaron and I had the opportunity to go on what's called a Global Connect trip. But it was such a life-changing trip where we got to meet in person a lot of our IWs that we support. And then 3 weeks later, Pastor Tim and Pastor Stu actually took a small group of guys to visit Life International School with Walter and Laura Hopkins. Pastor Stu, share what you guys did on that trip.
What didn't we do? We built all sorts of things. We built a playground for the smaller kids, put a padded floor down. We built cornhole boards for kind of the older kids. We built, put together a basketball hoop. We did some maintenance stuff around the school, and just loved on it.
Well, April, of course, is our big day. It's what we gear up for all spring through outreaches and invitations, which you guys all had a hand in. And we celebrate Easter. And this Easter was unique because I got the day off a little bit. Not totally, but you guys stepped up and were able to preach. And leading up to the big day, we had over 5,000 invites given away.
Crazy.
And that was a result of personal invites, so thank you for investing and inviting your friends. But it was also the result of campus outreaches that were going on. We had the egg drop.
That's right.
And then you guys did
traditional egg hunt.
Egg hunts. Yep. And then Pastor John and the Wellsville campus did a park and hop.
Park and hop with Peter Rabbit.
Maybe. Yeah.
Get Which your picture with Pete, and then
Peter Rabbit was blown out.
Yeah, we had a windstorm, and we only got to do the outreach for an hour. Yeah. The tables blew away.
But like 300 people showed up.
It was 300 people in an hour. It was fantastic.
Invites were handed out, which led to 52 first-time guests, which is really neat to see. And we had over 1,000 people in attendance on Easter Sunday. So we praise God for that. Right after Easter, cool story. There was Baptism Sunday, and we had one unique story at our Greece campus from a guy named Don.
To describe my journey with Christ, it's a roller coaster. The best way I can explain it is footprints, if anyone knows that. My mom used to have it, and a little plaque. It was, Lord, there were always two steps, and then when I needed you the most, there's only one set of footprints in the sand. And it took a lot of self-reflection to remember that it was God carrying me when I needed him the most.
Baptize you in the name of the Father.
I love that story. I love that imagery of Jesus carrying us when life gets really, really difficult. So we praise God for Don. He is the answer to many people's prayers, as well as a special guy in our Wellsville campus, Steve Van Skyver, where you were part of his baptism, as well as Chuck Ackerman, one of our elders.
It's a really amazing story about Chuck and Steve. They've kind of been friends their whole childhood, and Steve had gotten an infection in his foot, and the doctors could not figure out what was wrong. It ended up killing the tissues in his feet, and it was spreading, so they had to amputate and take his leg. And Steve shared this at Together Day, but there was an amazing presence of God in his life during that time of peace, where he was okay with everything that was happening. And through that, afterwards, he really committed his life to not just knowing about God, but really pursuing a relationship with Jesus. So it was awesome to be a part of that baptism with Chuck and Steve that took place at our campus. So it was cool.
And around that time, we started a brand new message series on the book of Galatians, and it was called Walking Free. Walking, walking, walking free. Walking, walking, walking free.
Jesus is my homie, and I'm walking free.
Something like that. And we studied through the book of Galatians, Paul's letters to the church at Galatia. And the theme throughout the book of Galatians was justification by faith alone. Justification by faith alone. And to illustrate that, I remember one of the sermons, I visited the Shinglehouse campus. So I roped you and Luke into my sermon.
Still not walking right from that.
No one here has a spiritual resume good enough to reach heaven. I'm going to illustrate it this way. I'm going to call Pastor Tim and his son Luke up, and we're going to use this as a jumping test. You guys are going to prove something for us. So this ceiling, we're going to say, represents heaven. And through your effort, through your jumping ability, you're going to try to reach heaven. You're going to touch heaven. So if you can reach the ceiling, that means you're good enough to get to heaven. You can jump high enough to heaven, right? So here's the catch, though. I'm going to get on Tim's back. I'm going to be Tim's baggage. So I represent sin. I'm weighing sin down. The Bible says that sin easily entangles us, and I think it weighs us down. So I'm going to get on Tim, and we're going to see who can jump higher. We're going to see who can get to heaven, okay? So ready? One, two, three.
Paralyzing.
Ready? All right, ready? On the count of three, you can jump up, try to touch heaven. One, two, three. Okay.
Okay, you guys can get down. Who jumped higher? I think it was Luke, right? But here's the point. Did either of them touch the ceiling? No. You know how ridiculous it is for us to say, you know, by my good merits, by my good deeds, I can somehow become a good enough person to get to heaven. That's how ridiculous it is. We all fall short of the glory of God, the Bible says. All of us have sinned. There is not one that's good. There's not one that's righteous. And so we can't relate to God by our good works, by our good deeds.
And at the beginning of May, we did some outreaches to prepare ourselves for a big day, which was Mother's Day. But you guys came up with some great outreach ideas that blessed the community, specifically the teachers.
Yeah, we were able to provide a meal for 250 of the Olean school district teachers. And it was super encouraging to them. They'd never had anybody come in and do that for them.
Yeah, so someone even wrote you a note.
Oh, absolutely. Just saying thank you so much for partnering with us and showing the encouragement that you support us.
We took bags of chips to the teachers just to let them know that they are all that in a bag of chips.
That's awesome.
And it was kind of cute. I had a little tag on chips. Yeah. But we took like 525 bags of chips.
Really, really, really good idea. And it was supposed to invite people to Mother's Day, which is always a really big day. This year we had close to 900 people come for that service, which was great. Seeing 18 kids across five campuses being dedicated to the Lord, which is always fun, one of the highlights. And then seeing the kids sing during the service. And then having the ability to honor the moms in attendance, and hopefully the moms out there felt blessed. And then in May, we did a special event at our Grease campus to appreciate the volunteers, something we've done the last several years, have a volunteer appreciation night, because volunteers are very, very, very important. Save people, serve people. Yes. And it was highlighted, volunteers pouring into the church in our VBSs.
Absolutely. Yeah. Our VBS was a great outreach into our community. We had over 60 volunteers that really just teamed up together, worked hard, gave up of their time.
Yeah.
You know, we had 83 kids come awesome. Throughout the event. 50% of those kids were unchurched kids, which is always a goal of ours to get. And we had the great opportunity to hand out 75 Bibles to kids.
Very cool. And that was in June. In July, we had a VBS at the Arcade campus.
Yeah, we did our VBS in Arcade in July. It was excellent. And like you said, it's all about, like, I love the volunteers coming together.
Yeah.
We had over 30 volunteers, had like 45 kids that came, and just, it was really awesome.
Pastor Tim did a cool outreach for the 4th of July. Ooh, that's right. I
got mine. Yes. Yes, we did. Actually, we had these cool glasses printed up for watching fireworks in Shinglehouse. And we were able to canvas the whole park. And there are tons of people. I'm talking probably 1,000, 2,000 people in the park.
That was kind of invite people to the summer series, which we're continuing in Galatians. You guys preached on July 2nd. It was Campus Pastor Sunday. And Stu, you were the live campus, so we have video footage of that.
Yeah, I actually started out my message with kind of a story of two different fruit trees and where we plant our roots and the impact that has in the fruit that comes from us. So check this out. Where we plant our roots has a great influence on the fruit that we bear. This is true in farming. It's true in our spiritual life as well. If we're influenced by the world, then our lives will represent the depravity of our flesh. If we anchor our lives on God, then we will live lives that represent His glory and His goodness.
And you know, we really got to see fruit from that message. God really blessed us, and we actually had a salvation because of that message. It was really cool,
Praise God.
It's always great to celebrate God's goodness.
Yep. Yeah, and that's actually really what kind of took center stage for Together Day this year in July, was the idea of celebrating God's goodness and faithfulness in life, and there was testimonies, and that we had a lot of really good food. We had the bounce houses where some people should have stayed out of them, but they didn't.
Guilty. I made it through the obstacle course.
I still have rug burn from that.
Yeah, it's really a great opportunity. It's kind of like a family reunion for us because we don't attend church every week with the same people.
That's right.
So it's good to get to see people eating and playing games with people from other campuses.
I think it's a reminder, like when you show up, like you might not see that person every week, but it says that person is my family member. That person is my family member. Yeah. And we need that if we're going to continue to be one church in multiple locations. And then in August, we had a special guest attend our church. We had actually a few special guests, but one of which was President John Stumbo from the national office. John was able to share with all of our leadership teams. And then in August, we also started a brand new message series called Made for More. Made for More, the five purposes of the church that God wants every single individual believer to live out in the life of the church. And so we had a little montage of sermon snippets that we wanted to show you from that series.
The God and Father of all creation is the only one worthy of worship.
Following Jesus is meant to be a personal relationship with God, but it's also meant to be lived out in the context of one another's.
As believers, one of the main things that we're called to do is to spread the gospel. And that happens through ministry.
I was this and now I'm that. I was depressed and now I have a freedom of my spirit. I was a sinner heading to hell and now I'm saved, saint of God, heading to heaven. There is a before and after, a difference. And if I hadn't invited Jesus into my life and experienced his salvation as a young man, I would not be married to the same woman 41 years later. And I would not, and I would not, and I would not, a whole list of things that would have been different about my life. So see, I'm not arguing for truth as I say that. I'm expressing the reality of an experience. So that's being a witness. And all of us can be witnesses. So.
Be intentional about really leaning into being a support, being an encouragement, getting to know, doing real life-changing fellowship with the people that you're sitting in circles with.
You know, what I love about that series is that it highlighted the purposes of why we exist. And in August, we saw those purposes lived out in our church. Discipleship and worship. One of the things I thought about was the story of Gabe Raptus and his baptism here right behind us in the river.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. Gabe was a regular attender as a teen. He was part of the youth group. He actually helped out with sound and stuff here. And he graduated, kind of trying to find his way, and then kind of hit a spot where he realized he needed Jesus. So he started coming back. We were able to reconnect, talk. He wanted to get baptized. So we did. We headed to the river, recorded it. It was awesome.
Cool. And there's a real life change there.
Oh, yeah, real life change.
There's a really special moment. We have that video for you to check out.
Gabe, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
And by his grace, will you pursue him for the rest of your life?
I will.
It gives me great pleasure to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Cover. Bear the Christ in baptism. Ooh, risen to newness in life.
Praise God for that. And then the other purpose that was clearly illustrated in our church was outreach. And you did your first ever backpack giveaway. And that's something that you've done for
multiple years now.
And you've seen a lot of fruit from that.
Oh, it's huge. And I love how we can pour into the community. We gave away 146 backpacks. Most backpacks we've ever given away.
That's cool.
And the thing I love about it is it's not just that many backpacks. It's that many kids. It's that many families that we get to show the love of Christ to.
Same thing for us in Shinglehouse. Like you said, it's a great way for us to pour into the community. All right, this is our first one. I don't know how many backpacks we had, but we gave them all away. I mean, everything was gone by the time we were done. And so it was great not only to pour into the community, but to watch the Shinglehouse campus gather for this outreach and to do it together. That's half the fun for me.
It is.
I love that outreach. I love what you guys are doing because it's investing in the next generation. Speaking of the next generation, not your generation, but the one you serve, Pastor Jonathan's back to tell you a little bit more about this past summer's summer camp.
Right. We had big numbers again at summer camp, had 78 teens and 28 adults there to pour into their lives and to disciple them. I spoke on the living waters, and so really hammered home about starting fresh with the gospel of Jesus Christ and getting baptized.
We have a short video for you to check out from this year's summer camp highlights. Was there like a powerful story that came out of
something? Oh, yeah, a couple of them. We have one girl went home, immediately told her mom, like, it makes sense now. I want to take my faith more serious. Mm-hmm. And then when it came to baptisms, David Green wanted to get baptized, and he got baptized here at the Wellsville campus the very next week.
That's awesome. And one of the things I love about the Shinglehouse campus that they do every year on Labor Day weekend is get out of the church building into the community. Sure. And because they can't do baptisms in the middle of winter, that's your Sunday that you really emphasize the importance of that next step of faith. And it's really cool to see how God shows up every year during that service.
Yeah, and this year in particular, I mean, baptisms, but one in particular that I want to point out is Ron Thompson. You guys remember his wife, Angela. We used to go get chicken wings at the roadside when we were renovating. She was our waitress. When we were renovating the Shinglehouse campus like 6 years ago. Remember praying for her and inviting her to church and telling her we were pastors, and she ended up coming to church, but her husband Ron did not. He had some bad church experiences, I think, when he was younger. Ever since she's been coming, she's been praying for him. Well, this day, Ron was coming to church to get baptized. Angela didn't know about it, but he came up to me after service and said, "Hey, brother, I want to get baptized." And I was able to have a conversation and say, "Did you accept Christ?" You know, and everything worked out, and man, we got to baptize him, and it was really powerful. And if you get a chance to talk to him about it, because he loves to share that story, and it is powerful.
So he's been coming to church.
He's been coming to church. I mean, even before that, he's been coming to men's group, asking great questions, totally involved.
God is at work, and so we finished off Made for More. We started a new series in September for our fall kickoff, which was kind of a unique series. Mm-hmm. It was called I Have This Friend. Mm-hmm. And it really dealt with a lot of the topics that maybe that our people struggle with. So it was to equip them and to help them, but also for them to be able to have conversations, meaningful conversations with people who may be struggling with suicide or dealing with a loved one who has cancer.
Real life situations,
a wayward kid. And so we wanted to show you just a recap, short recap of that series, I Have This Friend.
It's okay not to be okay. There's so many people in life that are going through so many struggles that we know nothing about. And the beautiful thing about the church, guys, is that when you walk in here into the sanctuary and your sanctuary at your campus, you look around at this beautiful mess that God has brought together, and you can know that you're not alone.
Sometimes God will look at the storm in your life and say, "Peace be still." And it's gone.
Yep.
And yet other times, the storm is still raging, but he can look at you and say these words, "Peace be still," and you can also experience a great calm. And what it shows is that God is Lord of all. He's Lord over you, the storm, everything. And so when you know that God and you walk through the storm, you can fear no evil, for God is with you.
What's interesting about that objection, or the objection of, why would a good God send people to hell, or something about judgment? It actually assumes that they have a moral standard to go by. So if someone wrongs someone else, if you're an atheist, you really don't have any grounds to stand on whether something is right or wrong. Because if we all just evolved from matter and there's no creator, then there's no law. But it's really interesting when that person has something wrong done to them. Absolutely. Like if I go up to you and punch you in the face and you're an atheist.
Well, that would never happen.
You probably wouldn't like that.
No.
And you say, "Why did you do that?" Well, it's like, why not? Why not?
Yeah.
Why would it be wrong?
And so we need to remember that if our children could become spiritually mature Christians with our parenting alone, then why do they need Jesus?
Right.
They wouldn't need a savior. If we could do it, then Jesus wouldn't have to come to be their savior.
Yep. Your friend might believe it. You say they believe in Jesus, say they believe in the Bible, and feel no condemnation from God, but they definitely feel condemnation from other people. So they say, I'm not doing anything wrong, so I'm going to pursue what I feel is right. The only problem with that, the Bible says there is a way that seems right to a man. There's a way that seems right to a woman that in the end leads to their own destruction.
Church has one mission, and that is to take the gospel to the whole world, and then we can just be with Jesus.
Mm-hmm. And when we talk about politics, what we first need to really realize is that we are of a higher kingdom than the kingdom of this world.
Amen.
There's a higher political platform than the kingdom and the platform of this world that we need to be aware of. And for Jesus, unity is a huge part of that, and that we can't let some of these lower things divide us.
Yep. Yeah, I loved preaching with you guys during that series. I do remember in Olean one Sunday, we preached on a sermon called I Have This Friend Who's an Atheist. Yep.
and trying to help our friends who are navigating doubts about if God is real. And during that message that week, one of our members from the Greece campus, Bob Battaglia, actually shared his testimony that we haven't released yet, but we wanted you to see it right now. So here's an atheist's story of coming to Christianity.
As he was reading his Bible, I said, "Greg, you're wasting your time. There is no God." My story begins during the Vietnam War as a 19-year-old. I was thrust into the horror of that war as I was stationed over in the Philippine Islands as a medical technician. I became very bitter what I saw, what man was doing to man. I became very bitter and angry with mankind. And as time went on, I was blaming God for the most part, and I became a very hardcore atheist. In 1980, I wound up being employed by Eastman Kodak Company, and there was another Vietnam veteran. Greg was a very vocal Christian, and one day when he was sitting very innocently eating his lunch, as he was reading his Bible, I said, "Greg, you're wasting your time. There is no God." And he just turned and he just simply and very gently said, "Bob, the Bible says a fool has said in his heart, there is no God." And then he just went back to reading his Bible. But what happened to me, I can only describe it as what Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, the word of God pierced me in such a powerful way that I walked away from him feeling very foolish. Deep within my heart, I felt that he had something that I needed. And so I began to talk to him more about questions that I had concerning the Bible and concerning eternal life. By the time that week ended, I knew that I was lost and I was on my way to hell. I knew that. When I got home, I fell to my knees and I began weeping and crying. And I said, "God, there's just no way that you can save me. I hated you. I blamed you for things that you were innocent of." And then there was this still small voice and this vision that I had of Jesus on the cross when he cried out, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And then I realized if Jesus can forgive those that drove those nails through his hands and feet, I guess he could forgive me. And At that point, I accepted the forgiveness of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Spirit of God, the grace of God just flooded my life. And it's amazing how God can take a hardcore atheist and give him a second chance.
So cool what God did in Bob's life. And that's why we're here. That's why we're part of the church and the community. Every year, you are intentional about engaging with the community during September through the fall kickoff or your fall festival. Wasn't that fun this year?
It was fun this year. It's kind of like a church picnic meets inviting people from the community. Yeah. It's really fun.
Amazing.
We also had a big picnic.
We did.
At the end of September, celebrating 10 years of the Olean campus.
Absolutely. So it was so awesome to be able to look back and see God's faithfulness over those 10 years of, you know, having the building be closed and empty to now where it is now and what God has done and what he has provided and lives that have changed. It was just an amazing day to celebrate.
Yep. And around the same time, we had small group signups happen with over 300 people across five campuses who signed up for small groups. That's about seven small groups per campus. And we put a heavy emphasis on life transformation and sharing the gospel in Sunday mornings where people are in rows. The life transformation and really eternity happens in small groups as well. And you were sharing a story about your small group.
Yeah, our men's group that is studying the book of Ecclesiastes, you know, what is the meaning of life? There was a night where one of the guys that attends just came in and goes, "I don't know if I have given my life to Christ." Mm. The whole group was just kind of asking him questions, encouraging him to a place where he had, by the end of the night, had given his life to Christ.
The very next month, we had our annual missions conference that we do every year. This year, we got to host Brandon Nutter. As a part of that week, you and Jonathan were intentional about making sure he could visit the student ministry as well.
Absolutely. So Jonathan organized the neon night and just knocked it out of the park.
And it was a big night full of glow-in-the-dark dodgeball, glow-in-the-dark nine square, food, just over 100 kids here together. So what better time to have Brandon share and really impact the teens' lives?
Well, Whoa, where'd you guys come from?
No. We're amazing.
Welcome back. Speaking of special nights, not only was Neon Night special, but every single year we do a trunk or treat, and it is one of the biggest outreaches of the year. I know in Wellsville, you got to tell them about Wellsville and how it went.
So Wellsville's been growing for a while, but this year with the weather and partnering with the Y and the Highland Park, we had over 2,000 people. It was amazing.
And so you guys had some trunk or treats as well. How did those go?
They went really well. We had, you know, right around 750 to 800 kids.
Who wins the prize for your favorite costume?
Oh boy.
Well, Lisa Zimmerman had a blow up unicorn costume, one of those blow up costumes.
That's
She was helping like with doing parking and stuff. Just the smile she put on people's faces, that was a lot of fun. We got pictures of her passed out afterwards, like laying on the ground when she was exhausted.
That's cool. You probably don't have any pictures of anything, but what do
Why
you got?
Honestly, one of my favorite ones is Luke's, actually. He taped a bunch of Smarties to his pants, and he won his Smartie pants.
Oh, that's amazing.
So, I bet I have pictures of that.
That's awesome. Well, we're into November, and in November, we had a new message series on the book of Ruth, and you guys kicked it off in week one talking about Ruth and Naomi's story from tragedy to the beginning of hope. And I really appreciate you guys sharing. You know, it's kind of the heartbeat of our church to care for the least of these, not only locally, but globally, which I love what you guys are doing through Operation Christmas Child Shoebox. Absolutely. You guys have packed a lot of boxes this year, right?
Well, close to 100 of them, sure.
I know we're filming it, you know, a little bit earlier than the Christmas season, but we would be remiss if we didn't touch on some of these amazing outreaches. I know you're doing our annual
Santa Claus Lane Parade.
You're doing?
We're doing the Christmas Magic event, which is a community event that we get to partner with.
Very, very cool. And you're providing a really cool event for the community.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty amazing. We're going to do Hubilation. Seth, our drummer, he actually is going to be the Grinch.
Very cool. And Pastor Tim?
Yeah, we're doing blessing boxes. We're going to bless families in our community with some needs, with some food, with family game night.
You're unleashing generosity, which is what this season is all about. Obviously, you know, we're in the middle of our Christmas offering season, and we kicked off our Christmas offering, Acts 1:8, to reach locally, regionally, and globally. Over $10,000 was raised. So we praise God for your generosity. We are well on our way to meeting this year's goal. So I thought we'd wrap it up today and end with where we started, emphasizing that prayer is a priority in our church, that prayer is the engine that moves the ministry of Crosstown. And so that's why we're going to start 2024 off with another 21 days of prayer and fasting. We'd encourage you to take a brochure at the end of the service and begin praying with your church family for God to do immeasurably more than we can ever ask or imagine in 2024. Yeah. To him be the glory. Amen. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
All right, church. Well, thank you for being with us for this year's Crosstown Year in Review.
I love
that. That was amazing.
Going all the way to the top again. Drop that old ball right on him where you know I'm sick.
I don't have my teleprompter. This is the best. That was the best, Jonathan, you get without a teleprompter. Someone hit an 8-point right out here. I walked over. Some guy who just...
You waddled over like a little penguin?
Pastor Stu here and John.
Pastor Eva and Pastor Stu.
40 guys to go. Two iron sharpens iron. They sharpen their swords and they smack each other. Just like Jimmy when he went camping with his friends in the woods. Even know
how to rap. A good enough spiritual resume to justify ourselves.
But we can have freedom.
Amazing. This is amazing. Keep going. Let's just keep going.
It was fine, but you're looking like that, so I'm trying to go over here. And you're.
I'm just sitting here with a smile. I'm like, no, I wasn't. I was just like.
Your eyebrows were up and you were like...
He was, wasn't he?
You were totally looking at me like this. And then you turned to Jeremy and you're like...
We got to see a great picture of that.